Besides the standard error, there are nice other measures that give us information of how precise an estimator is. A nice such measure is the so-called 95% confidence interval. And there's a simple rule of thumb to compute it. And what it essentially means is that with approximately 95% probability, we find an OLS estimator. So this means if we draw from our data generating process a sample and compute the resulting OLS estimator with 95% probability, we find that in the interval plus minus two standard errors around this estimator, we have the true coefficient of the best linear predictor beta star k against which this OLS estimator converges if we have a large sample size. Yeah, so this 95% confidence interval mathematically is this interval. We take our estimate, which we have computed from one sample, we subtract two times the standard error of it, that's the left border, and on the right border we take our estimate and add two times the standard error of it, and we know that in these intervals, in 95% of the cases, we have our true best linear predictor coefficient. And this interval is called the 95% confidence interval. And recall that if the number of observations n grows large, the standard error of our estimator converges against zero. So this 95% confidence interval basically gets smaller and smaller. And for very large observations, we are pretty sure, therefore, that the true coefficient is pretty close to our actual estimate. If you call the R command summary on the output of a linear regression, you interestingly don't see the confidence interval by default, but some other statistics. So the first column is basically the estimate. The second was the standard error. We have discussed those already. Then the third column here is the T value. The T value is simply the estimate divided by the standard error. So the absolute value of the t-value basically measures how many standard errors your estimate is away from the from zero. So here we have an estimate of 99, a standard error of 0.23. This means we are roughly 433 standard errors away from zero. And then this fourth column shows the so-called p-value, which I discuss in a moment. And the last column are the so-called significant stars. So you probably have heard about p-values already in your earlier statistics class. So one way how you can think about them that they are linked to confidence intervals. For example, if we have a positive estimated coefficient and let's say a p-value of 0.02, which means it's 2%, it means that the 98% confidence interval, so 100% minus 2%, so 100% minus the p-value, confidence interval starts exactly at zero. Yeah, and since the confidence interval is symmetric, we know if our estimate coefficient is 1.5, that the from zero to two times the coefficient, so from zero to three, is exactly the 95% confidence interval. If our p-value would be let's say 4%, then we know that the 96% confidence interval is from 0 to 3. If our p-value would be, let's say, 40%, then we know that the 60% confidence interval would be this interval. Yeah, so basically the p-value tells us the which percent confidence interval starts with 0, or if we would have a negative coefficient, the which percent confidence interval ends with 0. In other words, the smaller is the p-value, the more confident are that the true coefficient of the best linear predictor, beta star k, has the same sign than our OLS estimator, beta hat k. Finally, there are significant stars, which you can think of as a short description of the range into which the p-value falls. For example, our summary function has the following notation that if we have one star, it means that the p-value for this coefficient is between 1% and 5%. Two stars means that it's between 0.1% and 1%, and three stars means that it's smaller than 0.1%. Significant stars can be thought of as a short notation for the interval into which the p-value of a coefficient falls. For example, the summary function r has the following defaults. One star means that the p-value is smaller than 5% and larger than 1%. Two stars means that it's between 0.1% and 1%, and three stars means that the p-value is smaller than 0.1%. So the more stars, the more sure we can be that the true coefficient of the Bessemer predictor has the same sign than our estimated coefficient. So if we estimate a positive coefficient and we have a lot of significant stars, we can be pretty sure that the true coefficient of the Bessemer predictor is also positive. Interesting, this definition what a particular star means differs between R packages and also between articles that are published. Typically, there's a short line below a table that explains the definition. For example, in the Stargazer package, which we will use a lot to present a regression result, one star means that the p-value is between 5 and 10%, where the summary function basically there just puts a dot instead of a star. Anyway, so a common convention in empirical studies is that one calls an estimated coefficient significantly positive or negative, depending on its sign, if its p-value is below 5%. So an R summary function if it has a single star. And if it's between 5 and 10%, sometimes one speaks of weak significance. Well, there tends to be sometimes a too strong focus on this p-values and significant stars. So the idea is somebody wants to make a discovery, some nice empirical regularity, and he runs some regression and says, well, we find a significant effect, the p-value is below 5%, and so we have a scientific finding. However, there are problems if you concentrate too strongly on those p-values. For example, you don't look at the effect size. So maybe you find some significant effect, but the size is actually very small. Then you should rather maybe say we have a confidence interval that suggests that we have a very small effect instead of focusing on these stars and just say that it's significant. Typically, if you have a large enough sample size, you always find something significant, but it may not really be relevant from its size. And there are also other problems with p-values. For example, the American Statistical Association has put out a statement on p-values. You can search it and click on it, where they discuss a lot of these problems. And what they, for example, say, one should focus more strongly on the effect sizes and also on the confidence intervals. So there's no particular reason why you should focus so much on the zero. So recall that the p-value basically always gives us the information about the resulting confidence interval that would start or end with a zero. But why should we be so strongly focused on a zero? Just plotting the confidence intervals may be much more informative and basically gives more informative statements if one reads the empirical papers. And actually, I share this this notion. And I would have thought that probably if today's the summary function of R would have been newly implemented, one probably would have shown the confidence intervals instead of the p-values and these stars. But given that one has already written it, it's always typically you want to have some backward compatibility and not change too much in the function code. So we still unfortunately see a standard output p-values and stars instead of the confidence intervals. However, there are also simple R functions that directly show you the confidence intervals instead of the p-values and the significant stars. And I have already briefly discussed that there are different ways to compute standard errors, not only the default standard errors if you call the LM function, but they are so-called robust standard errors. And if you use robust standard errors, also the t-values, p-values, and confidence intervals will change correspondingly. Basically, all these statistics can be computed as a function of the standard error and the estimate. And if you use robust standard errors, then also Your p-values and confidence intervals will be adapted correspondingly.